Hello and welcome to Global Topics. My name is Dr. Mike Krasanik and I'm the Executive Director of the Center for International Engagement here at Bridgewater State University in Massachusetts. Global Topics is a program designed to highlight the work of our fine faculty who are engaged in a number of international research efforts. And we're pleased today to have Dr. Sandra Popiden from the Political Science Department. Welcome, Dr. Popiden.
Thank you very much.
Sandra, I know that you have been doing a great deal of work on a brand new country in the world, which many of us might not be aware of, and that's Southern Sudan. So tell us a little bit about what's going on. How did we get Southern Sudan? Where is it? And how things are going in that brand new country?
Wonderful. So Southern Sudan is a breakaway province from Sudan proper, which is the largest country territorially in the African region. And on January 9th of 2011, they had a historic referendum. And 99% of the population of the southern part of Sudan voted to break away from Sudan and the Khartoum government. And so in July, this upcoming July, they're going to declare their independence, and they will become the newest country in the world.
Mm-hmm. And these are people, why did they break away? What caused this separation from main Sudan?
Right. Well, Sudan came into being, they gained their independence in 1956, and shortly afterwards, in the early 60s, the issues, there were a number of different issues, but inequalities, discrimination among the southern population, which is largely black, Christian, and also traditional religions, and there was a separation that they had desired from the northern population, which is largely Arab and Islamic. And there were a number of different issues ranging from political discrimination, economic discrimination, and things of the like. And they engaged in civil war in the early 1960s, and that lasted all the way up until 1972 when they had the peace agreement. But after a few years of having a relative peaceful situation, that situation as well broke down. Again, the major reason was because of the implementation of Sharia law over the entire country.
Which is Islamic law. Islamic
correct,
law.
Right. Yeah. Over the entirety of the country, including the largely non-Islamic southern population. And so that served as a catalyst for re-engaging the conflict in 1983, and that conflict lasted all the way up until 2005, destroying a large proportion of the South and having a very, very high death toll. About 2 million people died in that conflict. So this was something that basically there had been long-standing violence going on basically nearly since the beginning the independence period. Mm-hmm. And so this was a longstanding belief that they should have independence and should not be under the government and reign of Khartoum.
So all this history of violence and civil war, and what chances does Southern Sudan have to become an independent sovereign nation without intervention from the north or from any other country? Do they have a chance, or what's there? I understand there might be some oil there. Is that
right.
part of the positive story?
Right. So there was a lot of concern as to whether the referendum would actually be even held and whether it would take place at all. So there was a lot of international pressure on Khartoum and Bashir, who's the president of the North, to hold the referendum, to allow it to take place. And it did take place, but there is the largely oil-rich region of Abyei, where they were also supposed to have their referendum and decide whether they were going to break away with the South or continue with the North. And that referendum did not take place along with the Southern Sudanese. So there are a number of outstanding issues, from oil to citizenship rights. You know, the oil is located largely in the South, but the production facilities are in the North. There are, that's a major problem that still remains unresolved. There are a whole host of unresolved sure. issues.
Now, what is the United States stake in this? I mean, do we have oil companies there? Do we want this Southern Sudan to succeed? What's our interest there?
We definitely do want Southern Sudan to succeed, and we are currently putting money in the pipeline to assist with the Southern Sudanese independence so that they can be able to have viability. In the short term, it's going to be quite difficult for them. One of the recent UN studies have shown that the eastern part of the southern region of Sudan is the hungriest place on earth. Mm. And so, you know, they have about 30 miles of tarred roads. They have a steep hill to climb. Mm. And that's, I've recently written an article for the Bridgewater Review where I talk about the need for massive international engagement in order to make the state viable. Mm.
So we are already putting in a substantial amount of foreign assistance to that country as well, and other countries, European countries
right,
as well.
Right. Mm-hmm.
But it needs a lot more.
A lot more, right. Okay. And sustainment over time, okay. Not a short-term interest, definitely
now,
long-term.
Now, you also hear a lot about the area Darfur, but that's not mm-hmm. in southern Sudan. That's in the western part.
Separate, and the violence that's been going on there, that's, when I talk about 2 million that's died in the north-south violence, that doesn't even include the Darfur conflict. That's mm-hmm. a separate conflict mm-hmm. that's been going on.
So what's your hope for the future here for southern Sudan? I mean, is this going to eventually work out over time, or is this going to be a failed state, as some have often used the term?
At this point, it's too soon to tell, but you know, you can definitely hope for the people. This is a fork in the road, and hopefully for the people of all of Sudan who have encountered you know, such a you know, kind of tragic history and such a history of filled with violence and pain and things like that, mm-hmm. that this will be hopefully a turning point for them, and that they will put the violence of the past behind mm-hmm. them, and they'll be able to move forward and live, you know, lives of peace and happiness, yeah, sure. and also have growth and development and the things that everybody wants.
Well, when you get 99% of the people showing up for the referendum, I guess it's a sign that
right.
people want that change and want
right.
to participate in a new
much
government.
So. Mm-hmm. Yeah. Very much so.
Dr. Sandra Popiden from our Political Science Department, I want to thank you for coming by and telling us about a brand new country in the world, and hopefully one that will succeed. So thanks very much.
Thank you for having me.
This is Mike Krzanik for Global Topics saying thanks for watching, and we'll see you soon.